Good evening. After some amazing crafted clothes and fabrics, we now have the pleasure of having Jacob van Rijs, one of the directors of MVRDV, presenting tonight. He will take about an hour to take you to some of his work. Jacob has a very interesting relationship with Archiprix. He actually was one of the winners of Archiprix Netherlands in 1990. And in 1993, they did an amazing smart trick. They had a fairly small office, but they were pitching for a fairly large project. Some of you might know it, the VPRO building. And obviously, the future client wanted to check out whether this young office could do the job. So they called a few friends left and right. They made their office a little bit bigger than it really was, and they got the job, and they did an amazing job. So you gotta be smart. 6 years ago, they started with a project in Pune, and ever since Jacob of Winny, Maas and Nathalie, Vries has been the one who's been coming to India most. We're gonna call him also Professor Jacob, because he's a professor at the TU in Berlin, with offices in Shanghai and Paris and Rotterdam. I welcome you in Ahmedabad. Thank you.
Well, great introduction and in a kind of, yeah, the pronunciation of the name is correct. It's funny just to hear that in India. But this is a great view. So many people, and for me, I've been to India quite a few times, but this is my first time to this place, and I noticed already, I should come, have to pass by more often. So I have a bit of a double role, of course, in my relation to Archiprix, but I was also asked to give some, like a small lecture, what we are doing. And I thought, okay, that's nice just to give a little bit of a background, a cross-section, what's on the board, but also a bit of history, some older projects. And I'd like to start with India, because it has a bit of a special corner, or more or less, in our office. We have one table where the Indian projects are happening, because somehow it is a bit of a special case. And because it wasn't really meant to be like this, it just happened somehow, MVRDV in India. Was somehow destiny, maybe. Anyway, last time I was in India, it was for a wedding, and that was, of course, also interesting. Indian weddings, quite spectacular compared to the Dutch setting. But what was really cool is that the wedding took place at our project that we were building in Pune. It was actually the daughter of the client that was the bride. So it was an extra reason to come by, because it was suddenly. The building it wasn't finished yet, but it looked amazing because it had this outline, neon, and they put a lot of lights inside, so it was like quite an amazing spectacle, even though it was only concrete, basically. Yeah? That was a bit of light. You can make architectural kind of magic, so to say. There was a temple, kind of a pop-up temple, basically, in the middle of the park in Pune. And I thought it was actually quite an amazing aspect that when you have a wedding at an architectural project, it is a kind of sign of a kind of approval, you could say, that people have somehow, they choose your building more or less as a background for the most important day of their lives. And we actually have some more of those. So that's we started to collect those weddings. So there's actually one wedding from, let's say, a lesbian librarian wedding in Spijkenisse. In our building, which is not so far from our office, and they really loved the library that we did. And there was some nice little corners, not meant to be like that. But then suddenly, people discovered that as a great photo opportunity. Of course, the market hall is also a very popular location for weddings. Maybe I don't know how many, but there must be more. Indeed, there. And we asked around, and we found some other ones. These is a really beautiful picture. You have to look really well, because they're not standing on the ground. You see, they're just floating. Anyway, architectural wedding location. So that you could say if you have a wedding at your building, you could say okay, then at least you succeeded somehow. So this is maybe the aim for the architecture. Yeah, but make more wedding locations. So the Pune thing was like this. It was when I came back, I showed this in the office. Everybody was like, "Wow, it looks so cool." But it is also So it's interesting to notice how that changes the night and the day, because on the other hand, this is a huge building where 1,000 apartments are in one block. So it's our biggest building so far in terms of square meters and so on. And it's, I'm also quite fascinated by this scale, because it has a scale that hasn't been, let's say, that popular. You could say you have a lot of big buildings and big projects that are being built all over the place, and a lot of them in Asia. And as you go to these cities, you see them, but you don't really see them in the architectural magazines. We did an overview at the Wire Factory of a scan of the magazines, what type of projects are being shown in the magazines. And this is the least popular, let's say, category, the buildings above 100,000 square meters. They somehow are not that interesting. But on the other hand, if you look at them, in terms of square meters and sheer mass, it is by far most square meters are built in these kind of gigantic projects. So I'm quite fascinated by to make buildings in this scale, but then try to make them differently, because there's a lot of repetition. Obviously, also in India, you have a simple floor plan and you copy the floor plan. And then you repeat it, and then you have the building. And so that's quite fast. And the first attempts that we did in India, we also misunderstood the meaning of a preliminary design and a sketch design, because a sketch design is very detailed in India. Here you see a typical housing plan, and what you notice is that it is repeated from inside. So you have one house that's flipped, and then the whole thing is flipped again. And then you have the floor plan, and then you have the building. And in Europe, we have a different way of working. We more or less work from outside in. We have the perimeter that comes from the urban context. And then you try to fit in all the square meters and the layouts until the puzzle is there. Whereas in most Asian, and also in India, you work from room by room. You make an ideal floor plan, and then when the house is there, then the building is also there. Quite different. So our introduction to India was like, hey, how can we deal with this? How can we make the ideal floor plans? We looked around a bit. We found some layouts, and like, hey, how do you enter? Which room first, and so on and so on. But this is more to get in. Into the feeling. So because there's another issue as well. You have this. Our first project was in Pune, and it was not in the center, but it was in the so-called township. And I think about townships. Then you think about South Africa, but in India, a township is probably it's a kind of new neighborhood with everything included. It's like a sort of miniature city. And in a way, you can live in this township like the Truman Show. You have your own world, basically. And you're plucked in the city, and when there you have all the chaos, and which is also interesting, but it's also understandable that people choose for a life in a township kind of Truman way, next to the kind of chaos of the city. So maybe if I put myself in that position, I think, okay, maybe I would also live in a township when I was an Indian and have a family and everything. Here's our client, and he is super proud about his development, Amanora City. It's like maybe his lifetime achievement, you could say. He's been working on it for a long time already. And he was asking for an ID for the spine, the high density spine of this township. That was the competition. And we just actually had a kind of unlucky event with an Indian client before. It didn't really work out. But we learned a lot from that. And we put all this knowledge into this competition. By making a kind of an efficient project. This was the envelope. It was a building height of 100 meters, and overall it should be around 350,000 square meters in the whole envelope. And we started to play around, and the first idea, let's go for towers. That was the most obvious one, but we noticed that it didn't really work out, because you get this crazy amount of more than 80 towers, and it would hardly fit. You could also make a wall, bend the wall a bit. And finally, we found a way to
to deal with that by making a kind of ideal grid based on the distances between the fire lifts. So the maximum distance between two cores can be 60 meters. So you have then the escape length. Now, if you did this, and we did it in a hexagon way, we had a sort of solution which would be, which would give the minimum amount of cores, which we thought was interesting because then you had more views and let's say more efficiency, and also a different way, so to say. So this was the principal layout, and then in this is the corridor, and all these fields we could sort of organize apartments inside. But we did it in a different way. We just measured all the rooms, and we measured the amount of facade that was needed. And we didn't want a facade like this, but the opposite. We want to have a smooth facade, and the inside was more irregular. So in our system, we found out that there was a kind of grid in which we could mix all the apartments. So we had not one type, and then we copy it. You copy it again, you have the building. But we have the kind of the maximum freedom of different units inside one floor, for instance. That was quite radical, because normally you have one type in one building, and here we had a unit which is quite small, and a super big one, and something in between, all on one floor. And this was, okay, a bit different. The client was a bit surprised by it, but on the other hand, he saw the potential of it, and he thought, okay, let's do it, let's organize like this. Because they could also more or less program the building, so we made the basic units, and they had a whole team of marketing people making the product mix. The product is then the apartment, and in that way all these apartments could be find the position. So we told them that you can make one building with one size and the other building with the other size, or you have small apartments at the bottom, big apartments at the top. But the nicest one is of course a kind of mixture of everything. And in a way this was what happened. Step by step the building was designed, and the ideal mix was made by the team, basically. We didn't design this ourselves, in the sense that we gave them the ingredients and they did the cooking, the final positioning of the apartments. Every piece of it was different. And the first building was this one. This was the one that I showed in the wedding section. This over there. In the meantime, we're working on the second stages, which will look slightly different, but it's part of the same principle. So the idea is that we have kind of the typical apartments in the middle, but the building is chopped off, and there you would have larger ones with a panoramic panoramic window to the park, and also on the top you would have then special roof decks. So this is one of these apartments from the with like a super long balcony, and the ones that are on the top have a kind of depending on the angle of the roof, a certain size of roof deck. So there was a mixture of like extreme, super-sized apartments, let's say 5%, and also tiny ones. So this is all in one building. Of course, you have these sales centers. You know that, but for us, it's quite new. Before the construction starts, there is already a kind of a shop where you can buy the apartments. And it was a website, so you can actually, this was all done by their team. Also the Indian renderings, which we cannot make, because we have a different taste. And I mean, we tried, of course, but it was hopeless. So, too sophisticated. So it had to be all kind of brown, beige, with a little bit of green. But this is the taste of the average Indian, let's say, Pune, whatever, home buyer. Now here's the layout. Of course, this is all, this is the so-called 1.5 BHK. Yeah, you know that, but bedroom, hall, kitchen. So this took a while. You know, this is a typical Indian phenomena where you describe this, the apartments in like this, the 2.5 BHK, and then you know exactly what you mean. So in a way, it's like a car. You have an MPV, you have a station wagon. So they all have certain amount. People have an expectation. So there's not that much flexibility in the layout. But on the other hand, in the combination of the layouts, we thought there is actually quite something possible in India. So here you see these images. And we also made kind of collective spaces in the building, also to get a kind of cross ventilation. but also kind of additional shared facilities. So this is an early render that we did. And then the team from the clients took these renderings, and we had a good laugh when we got them back. Because this was the... they said, no, we have to style them in a bit different way. So they have this one, and they have this one. And so, yeah, that you can start to cry. But on the other hand, we thought, okay, let's just take it as it is. You cannot make perfection in India. But you can also do, so you have to play with that. So that means you have to accept that the details are not perfect. But on the other hand, there's other aspects that are really amazing. In this case, the type of the overall element of the building and the scale of things. And when you move around, it's like, wow, this is something that's impossible in the Netherlands. So things started to be on site, and it went on and on, but it was a lot of concrete. It was like an army of construction workers there. I was super scared when I went up to the building site. Safety measures are not India's strongest point, so to say. But you could say it was an experience, yeah, a building site in India. And it has also a certain beauty. And you have to imagine then the sound. It was a mayhem, so to say, on the building site. But now this is getting more and more organized, and the building is, on one side, is more or less finished. People are living here. And on the other side, they're still building it. So people ask me, when is it finished? And I have no idea. It is finished, but when you look from a certain corner, it is finished. And then look from the other side, it's still half finished, so to say. And also, yeah, there's a lot of things that are not good. But on the other hand, I'm also very excited when I see it and when I go there. So what we did is we made a simple kind of more or less grayish stucco, cement color. Let's say, because everything gets a little bit dirty after a while, so that means if you make a white building, not a good idea. So slightly gray, it might get a little bit darker. And we had all the collective elements have a certain color depending on the courtyard where they're looking at. So here you see, and also because the irregular volume gives a fantastic kind of skyline, and from where you when you walk around on the ground, every corner is slightly different. So the main view towards the park is like this, and the second building, which will be next to it, there were new regulations. This is another phenomena. Every now and then you have new regulations in India, and then everything stops. One kind of interesting regulation was that this is of course quite a unique building because it's not a tower, it's a kind of slab, and there was a new regulation that the length of the building should be the distance between the next building. So if we would have made the same building there, it could not be here, but it had to be there. So by chopping up the building, it fitted again in the regulations. And so this is, let's say, 5 years difference in design, and these regulations dictate the outcome of the shape. So this, from a certain angle, this will be towers. From another angle, it's part of the same skyline. So I'm not sure when this will be done, but it is going to happen, I think, one day, depending on market conditions. Pune, yeah. In the meantime, we're doing some more Indian projects, and every time we try to kind of deal with the fact of this, it's mostly residential for project developers. In a way, that's the first step. Maybe there will be a different type of commission coming, but at the moment, it's mostly kind of big blocks. And this is the building we're doing in Lucknow, which is also under construction. And here we also used, let's say, standard apartment layouts. And instead of making separate towers, we put these towers together in a block, making them in different heights. So you have a lower building here and a higher building there. So it goes up and down. It's right on the riverside. And altogether, we make it out of orange brick. So it will be some sort of a castle, the orange castle. Inside, all brick, everything in the same color. So all the fences will also be in the same color. This is a simple design guideline, because there will be a sketch design done by us, schematic design, and then the definitive design is done by a local architect. And then, you know, things can go a little bit wrong. Nothing negative about them, but, you know, certain things just change. So we told them, like, there's a simple rule, everything is the same color. And this is we thought it would be a good thing to have simple guidelines, and the effect will be okay. So if it's slightly not okay, the detail, it still has the one color. So from a distance, it looks good. No, not joking. But anyway, so this is a kind of a super courtyard, which we asked some friends from Berlin, Topotec, to make an internal garden in the same basic material, also with brick. There's some brick climbing domes. There's a voliere with birds. So this is the collective courtyard for the apartments. Every apartment has balconies and so on. So this is, it's somehow a different, it's in very Indian, but at the same time it's not typical Indian. So this is what we can bring to India, I think. We don't have to change everything, but with a few things we can do something. So it would fit in a kind of row of buildings that we have been doing throughout the years. Every time a new invention, in a way. This is the Silodom. A lot of different apartments on top of each other, but everyone has a different facade. Or in Madrid, a block on the side. Or in Copenhagen, an existing silo turned inside out with apartments with a view. Or the Hanging House in Amsterdam. So this is, in a way, part of the collection, the Indian collection of residential buildings that we are making throughout the years. In a way, this is maybe the big plan every time. A new chapter to this topic. It's never boring in a way. But as you are mostly young architects, I think it's important to talk a little bit about the future. This is already a few years old, but I think it's still interesting. What type of architects are we needed, are needed in the world? So there's still to be expected more and more people coming. So that's in a way not too bad for architects, you would say. The cities are growing, but you think, what is interesting is that there is there's more building being planned, there's more construction, but there is a reduced in demands for architectural services, which is already strange, yeah, because you have more people, more buildings, less architects. Why? Now, I think it has to do with the fact that a lot of things are done already by other people, and that the role of the architect is changing. So you have to invent and try to imagine, what type of architect do I want to be? And how do I, well, what can I offer? Because I don't do all the architectural work in India, because other people can do that better than me. I make an idea, somebody else is developing it for me. And before, let's say 50 years ago, the architect was the hero, everybody was listening, and now more or less people do it themselves. So they have their software, and they look at the television, they have these television programs on how to decorate your house. You can do it on a simple SketchUp model. You can say, hey, could the contractor make it work? So different thing. And on the other hand, it became more and more complicated. So in the old days, there was architect with everything. It's a kind of one homo universalis did all the work. And right now, here's the architect. And there's a whole bunch of people around the table, if you have a more complicated project, with all kind of specialisms. With acoustics, with fire, with light, with, of course, landscape, and then all the technical stuff, the cost calculation, the project managers, and it's absolutely, it's a different game, so to say. So these two things are happening. On one side, more complicated, more specialisms, so you can also decide, maybe I should be a specialist. Or I want to be the person in the middle who knows a little bit of everything. And it's a different type of profession in that respect. And for us, as an office, we it also changes in the sense that we have to work together with all the specialists. And in the last few years, we started to change the methodology of working by introducing Revit and everything like this. So no AutoCAD anymore. It was a kind of small revolution. You see the Indian project, perfect for Revit. Everybody was like, hey, this is actually working really well. And then we can collaborate with others in a different way than before. And also, for instance, in the project here, in the Danish project, we worked together with an architect in Denmark, but we were doing the facade and they were doing the interior at the same time. It doesn't really matter, because you work in the same 3D model, and then the engineer can put in the pipes or whatever, and the steel beams. So this is an interesting aspect, changes a lot. Yeah, also the teamwork, how you collaborate. So there's a kind of practical side, but there's also more, let's say, holistic side, maybe how where the future is going and what is the all professions are changing because of technology. What does it mean for architecture? This is an interesting book. You can read about it, what it means, the technological development for the transformation of the profession. Okay, well, a lot for us in our studio, it has to do with how you work together in the team. So we moved about 9 months ago to a new building, and it was took a long time to organize, but this was part of the, let's say, yeah, growing up. So we were, got a bit bigger. There was about new opportunities came around, and we said, okay, let's move, let's go. And we took it quite serious by asking our staff, hey, where do you want to work? What type of studio you like to be in? And so we had a team inside the studio that was actually developing the interior design for their own studio, which was in a way interesting because we were our own client. And so one of the things that came out of it was that we really liked meeting rooms, talking. So many meeting rooms, there were not enough meeting rooms, so we had to make more meeting rooms than possible. And still, we now have 12 meeting rooms, still not enough. And you work behind a computer and then you step out of the room and you talk, you sit around the table in different settings. So we have orange meeting rooms, we have white ones, blue ones. Every meeting has a different mood, depending on the situation or who is coming. You can book them in the Outlook agenda, and it's quite a funny change of atmosphere. We also have meeting rooms on the stairs. We can so the organizations like this, you have on one side people working without meeting. If you want to meet, you step out of the working room, and it's in the social zone, so to say. Here's the lunch table, and the building is an old building from the 50s. Rotterdam was damaged in the war, and this is one of the first buildings that was built after the, let's say, the reconstruction. And it was a building where all kind of firms that lost their spaces could move into. So it looks like an apartment building, but it's like a housing building for offices. And in the workshop space, this is now our office. And here you see it again, here. Roughly the center, which was wiped out. And over there, we are now, have built the market hall, which is standing in the center of Rotterdam. It used to be the center, so to say. And this is where it is right now. It's more or less 2 minutes walk from our office. It was not planned, but it's quite handy. When people come to visit, we take them out. And it's in the middle of the old city. Here is the market. Here's the cathedral. So this old map of Rotterdam. And it was quite interesting to see that there was actually a market on the location of the new market hall. And this was another kind of request. It was a competition between developers. And our idea was to combine this housing and the market into one building. The plan was you make apartments and you make a market. And the market was supposed to be more or less, yeah, was supposed to be paid by these apartments. So the revenues from the apartments would finance the market. So the city didn't have to pay for the market. And we thought it was actually much more interesting to flip it around, because then the market would be much higher and we would have an interesting penthouse roof layer. So the developer was also happy. We could move it a bit and turn it into this shape, which is the ideal shape for the lift, a beautiful interior, and a perfect match for the apartments around it. And it became a kind of signature shape, recognizable and iconic, but also quite functional, so to say. It was an arch, a kind of, and then the structure, let's say the houses they made, they built the hall for the market, which is basically a public space, an outdoor space, covered with a windscreen and a rain screen. So you can walk through it and you don't have to buy anything, but it's like a kind of like a living room for the city. The section is interesting because here you see parking, supermarket, some shops, and here all the different apartments. So every time, yeah, the higher you would go, the internal wall is changing. You have a window to the food hall. So this was the cartoon we got from the client. And we were talking and talking about that these windows had to be openable, because then you would be able to catch more or less the fish of the day and cook it. But it was complicated with all the regulations and everything. So the windows were not openable, they're closed, but you still have the feeling it had to do with all kind of fire regulations. It's like an aquarium of activities out there. So you have some of the rooms are to the inside, and then this space is like this. And if you are higher up in the building, this wall is changing in angle, and you look down in it. It's funny to see. We went back after the building was finished. People decorated their own houses, how they are organizing the interiors. These people are like this. She has the cook island, so to say, with a window to the market. More traditional home. Two guys. She's our favorite inhabitant of the market hall. She's we can always pass by. We have the key of her apartment, and when she's not home, and we have guests, then we say, we made a deal, so to say, which is great for her and great for us. Another one. Which actually shows the top apartment. With when you come in, at the lowest floor, you look down to the market hall, and then the main floor is here. It has a kind of patio in the middle of the on top of the hall with a glass floor. And there you can stand on the glass floor, and then you look down to the market hall. For those with vertigo, there's some people did cover it, but most people have the glass window, and most other apartments have, of course, a regular balcony and a view to the city. But even from the inside, you can also, from the corner, you can also look out diagonally to the church, because we wanted to make this screen facade as transparent as possible, so that it was almost not there. It actually can move with the wind. It's like a big tennis racket. So this is a concrete structure, and in two directions you have cables spanning in tension. And they hold the glass, and they actually can move. So this in the middle can be more or less 60 centimeters in, 60 centimeters out, depending on the wind. It's not a fixed structure. Otherwise, it would be a heavy steel structure. So it was actually cheaper. The only thing, it was more expensive for the engineer. So they had to pay a bit higher fee for the engineer. But then in the end, the result was an efficient facade. Of course, the inside, you see already, this is this gigantic art piece. We wanted in the beginning to make a movable, like a big TV screen out of it. It was complicated. And at a certain moment, the decision was made, no TV screen. What do we do? We make it out of a big mirror, some like gigantic disco ball. But in the end, we decided together with the client that it should be an art piece. When you don't know what to do, you ask some artist, basically. Yeah, that you hear that more often. But in this case, of course, a reference like to the Roman chapels, highly decorated, beautiful interiors. The competition was won by a local artist. Here you see the client. There was does it work? So, and you could see that they're sitting inside a miniature version of the market hall. That was the sales office. So we do have sales offices in Holland as well. So where people could actually see what is it like, this hall. This is the image. It was a computer-generated image, which was so big that it would not fit on any computer. So it was rendered in different computers. Actually, it was with the help of Pixar to have the resolution. And then it was chopped into pieces. And these pieces then were printed in a special factory, aluminium. Every panel was different. So this technology was there. It was not that much extra to make all the panels different. So there was a coating on it, and then the big puzzle could start. And it was relatively quickly applied to the facade. Some of it is smooth, but most of it is perforated for the acoustical absorption. But you don't really see that from far. And that's the effect. So you have people come in, and the first thing they do is like, what is going on? And it has an overwhelming interior. But these two things together, let's say the art piece and the architecture, they really, one and one is three, so to say. at night it glows out, especially in the winter time. Yeah, the market hall kind of is like a big lamp for the city, and that part of the city actually really lifted up, moved up, so to say. Below you have the parking, and from there you pop up in the middle. There's a series of small vitrines which show archaeological findings that were found during the construction. As this right in the middle of the old city, there was lots of history, so to say. And on the outside, we thought to actually make the most boring facade, so to say. You have this super colorful inside. And on the outside, we take the material that is used for the sidewalks, kind of granite, gray granite, and put it in the facade. So that, like the building comes out of the ground of the city. So there's neutral, blending in the surroundings of the let's say the public space. And there are some views. So Rotterdam is, it's let's say changed in that sense. Because suddenly people, come. There you see tourists in Rotterdam. That was something that was hardly there. But let's say Rotterdam's on the map, and architecture played a role in it. Big buildings. But I think it's not only that. I think it's also a combination of bottom-up, where you have, in this case, the kind of DIY housing, where people can obtain a house for a little money, make it, convert it, improve it. And it's a kind of recipe of urban renewal that started in Rotterdam, because houses were so cheap for a while. And this is a way where somehow the old atmosphere is the same, but on the inside of the houses, it's completely different. And every house is again ideal and different again. So this combination where people can design their own house and make their perfect, let's say, castle, ideal castle in the city. You can do it here as well in this type of DIY housing, where this is an old house, let's say, 100 years old, and the inside and the roof, the foundation, everything is kind of improved, and it can just live for another 100 years forward, so to say. So there's a couple of these projects, but this is another favorite one of mine. This is a roof park on top of an existing shopping center, which is linked to an old neighborhood, making a balcony to the harbor. There's a lot of harbor spaces, and I think there's still for many generations projects to come in Rotterdam, because the harbor is more or less the same size as the city. I think for the next 100 years there will be spectacular things happening in the harbor areas of Rotterdam. And it's already, you can see that in these halls, the harbor, this was an old submarine hall with Trinity Museum. Other ones become hipster places where you can eat expensive food, but in a cool setting. Some of them are temporary, like for this case for a circus school. So this combination of this, let's say, the new stuff in the architecture completely new, and the transformations, they make an interesting duo, so to say. They play a part in the game, so to say. And for us as architects, these type of commissions become more and more on the boards, where you are asked to make transformation from an existing construction. And sometimes it's a very ugly one, but that actually maybe the better. The uglier the better, so to say, because that allows for certain freedom that you don't have when you have a new building. I like to show this one, which is the Rock Magneten in Denmark. It's on a former factory building, a cement factory in Roskilde, which is not so far from Copenhagen. And this is a city that is it's an old historical city, but it's also the city where the biggest rock festival of Scandinavia is taking place in June. So everybody knows Roskilde from the festival, and the city wanted to use that in a way by making a museum for rock music and youth culture. It's an interesting phenomenon where within, let's say, a couple of weeks, 100,000 people make a city. And of course, it's Denmark, so they do it in a very interesting way, sustainable. There's all kind of interesting experiments taking place in terms of, let's say, urbanistic elements. So that's interesting place. So in between the festival and the city, there's this factory. The city bought a factory to make it into a cultural destination. The competition was make the rock museum that expresses, let's say, the vibe of the festival and shows, let's say, but in a different way, in a museum way. Okay, so architecture and rock music, how to deal with that? We thought that would be nice to play with the iconic materials from rock music, like leather jackets, red velvets, flight cases inside, speakers, whatever. Yeah. You know it. And to see how can we transform that into architecture. And at the same time, another element, like when you have the band, there's different, let's say, characters in the band. They're not all the same. You have the lead singer, you have the drummer. So we had to make a development for several buildings, and the museum was the singer, was Mick Jagger. There was an office building and a school, so everyone has a different position and a different character. I'll show you now the movie we made for the competition, and give you some time to have some water. So this was then, we showed the perspective and the potential of, let's say, an architecture that would express the kind of the glamour and the sort of the sexiness of rock music. But then, of course, you had to have to make it. So it was also a very simple building by making a super simple block on top of the hall, cladded with aluminium studs, and then working it out. It was actually a rather straightforward design, as you can see. Of course, the structure was the main thing to solve, but on the inside there was a black box of the exposition space and the kind of red space where the entrance hall, the lobby of the museum is. There's a red carpet rolling towards the street because we were the only entry that was actually positioning the rock museum on top of the halls. All the other entries were making a new building, a bigger new building. So you have to draw the audience, so to say, inside. Then the canopy is like, yeah, let's say when you walk towards it, like you are becoming a rock star. Huh? You go to this building and you really feel the impact. You feel like a rock star entering the building. At night, you can see the effect of the windows and the glowing of the red carpet below the golden studs. So here we did only the building, and the interior was done by another team of exhibition designers. That was a risk, of course, but I think we gave them an image, like, well, maybe something like this, flight cases, simple, simple idea of the furniture, a concrete bar, and more or less it was, they more or less did what we asked for, so to say. This is the interior, so this is what we did, and then later on I'll show you some stuff that happened later. The patio. And this is the script that we taught at the competition, like what would it be like to visit the building. So you come on maybe in a limousine, you walk over on the red carpet, you take a big elevator, which is a career boost, and then you enter the exhibition itself, where you see the whole story of the life of a rock star, and ultimately there's a kind of the way down, because one day the popularity ends, and then you go outside. And the opening, it was a really big event in Denmark. They made a whole weekend free entrance, and a lot of people performing there. So it was fun. But even continuing, the building attracts, like say, different generations. So there's a lot of old rockers, and there's new rockers. So people bring their kids, and there's all, for everybody something to see. So there's the latest music and the old stuff from the 70s and earlier. Exposition was fun. You have a gigantic record player. There's a whole kind of interaction. So it is a fun place to go for the whole family. One more Dutch one, and I think depending on the time. Some water, you have to drink, yeah, sorry. This one we are working on at the moment. So it's a work in progress for a cultural building. It's a mixture of different public functions in the city of Zaandam. In Holland, there's an interesting debate going on. It's already, maybe already a bit over, but between, let's say, the modernistic approach and the, let's say, the retro architecture. So a lot of people think that there's only modern architecture being built, but there's a lot of retro architecture being built in Holland as well, actually much more than the more modernistic approach. So this is a very successful type of architecture. People like that a lot. And it's also proven that it's when you buy a house like this, it's a better investment than when you buy a modern house. So there's two sides to it. So there's one city where that played that card in a different way. They used the traditional architecture from this case Zaandam, and turned it into something different. This was done by an architect called Stuart Suters, and he made a kind of open air museum for traditional architecture for it. This is the town hall. There he enlarged all these little houses into gigantic, iconographic office buildings. There's the little canal. Here's the town hall. There's a hotel with stacked little houses. We think, well, that looks pretty cool. And so it's in a way, it's a Disneyland, but it's in an interesting, it's also interesting. So we also were fascinated by this approach where you link a local style, but then you try to extend it into the future, making it both traditional and modern at the same time. And so this was the setting of the competition where we had to deal with how to deal with history, how to deal with this little house and turn it into something else. So there was this, the town hall was done, the hotel, what's next? We had to make another chapter into this collection of old houses in a new way. The program of the building was a collection of public facilities for the arts and the cultural life of the city. The art house film center, there's a stage for rock music, the artists, the music school, the dance, the radio, the library. All of these had their own identity. They were not in the same building before, but the city said, okay, you have to come into the new building, otherwise we don't give you money anymore for a subsidy. So it was more or less a forced marriage of different institutes into one new house. And we thought, okay, when we make it the element of the house is maybe an interesting starting point. It was already, of course, given by the context, but we can turn it into a living room. In Dutch, that's a house room. But if you turn it inside out, this house could become a negative space, a hollow space, a void space that could be the connecting room for all the different users. And then we would have a new chapter, so to say, dealing with that element of this historical house. But this, in this case, is the house that's carved out of the block. So we have a block, and every group, every institute would have their own living room, and we try to combine it in such a way to create this almost like a church, a hollow church, in that block of different house-like rooms. So here we have individuality of the different institutes, and they also share a lot of facilities. That was, of course, the big thing, that in the end they would use less square meters. It was a cost saving, but then into a new kind of interactional destination in the city, right next to the central station and the town hall. With this turnaround, we thought it would be interesting to have the exterior facade on the inside and the interior facade on the outside, in the detailing of the building. So you have an imaginable, a facade that looks like wallpaper, and the inside of the building has a facade of the typical houses. Certain elements from local details were then introduced, and this is the space what you get. And we made a movie, actually the city made a movie, because right now there will be a big debate in the city. Architecture becomes very democratic, so to say. There will be a referendum about this building. where people of the city can say, yes, we like it or we don't like it. And depending on the situation, yeah, we could end up with a building or without a building. Let's see. In a way, it's a populist building, but on the other hand, a lot of people have something against culture. So. The main hall, where the different functions have their own address. This is the door towards the rock club, so to say, where the concerts for the local bands take place. Higher up, the art house, the cinema, with the lobby, and below the stairs you have the cinemas themselves. Radio, the library, and on the side they have the so-called art center, where there are courses for sculpture and all kind of the modern arts, so to say. There's the performing room, which we where concerts from the music school take place, and the theater classes and so on. Spaces from the arts school. There's a roof deck in the form of a house. So next month there is this. There will be this referendum probably, and then we hope to continue. But let's see. I'd like to end with one project that was built last year in Amsterdam, Crystal Houses. And it's a historical context where we had to combine, let's say, the world of the big brands with the traditional Amsterdam feeling. And the PC Hoofdstraat is a phenomena in Holland. Let's say it's the most expensive shopping street, but it's also the place where you can spot the most expensive cars and also the wives of soccer players doing whatever. Anyway, so it used to be a residential street, and it, step by step. So it was never completely a shopping street, but then you see every now and then a facade was changed, and then a shop window was made. And in the end it turned out into a gigantic open air mall, so to say. And with the typical Amsterdam houses above. So what we had to do is we wanted to mix, let's say the flagship store with the traditional local context, have a global brand and a local context combined. In this case, it was not a real user. It was not a kind of a brand, specific brand. So we imagined a kind of almost neutral luxury feeling. And we wanted to start with this, the old houses that they were supposed to go, because many of these spaces are empty because the doors are not, they're used for the shop. So there's no access anymore. And step by step, this is being changed, and the city wants to reintroduce these into this access again by having apartments on top. One of the things to do that is that you could make one floor extra. This would create so much revenue that you can demolish the house and build it again. And so this would actually be a kind of operation that makes sense. So this was there was a plan made, and we thought that our client was not that happy with that. It was designed by somebody else, but it was approved. And we said, okay, well, we can make it different, but we don't have to make a new design. You can basically take the old house that was there before and stretch it a bit. And then, you have the same atmosphere. Why would you need to make a new house? And the only thing, of course, how to deal with the view in the shop window. So we found, look at the old the drawings that were in the archive. This is the design. And we just stretched it up, so to say. This was the old design that was approved by the other architect. And then we said, okay, let's just take the original design, map it over it, stretch it, and then it works. So then it would look like this. And then our clients, yeah, that is a great idea, but now I still have a problem because I don't have a shop window, so we have to do something about it. And then we found this fantastic brick, and we thought that is a really good, really cool idea. Let's make the whole thing out of this brick. It was a glass brick, and then the whole thing would be transparent, and everything was great. Except he liked the idea, but then the city said, no, this is not a good idea, because we like to have the continuation of the brick on top floor. So it should be like this. There's always this negotiation element in Holland. In this case, yeah, there was no way about it that this would be glass, so it had to be brick. Then the question was more like how to deal with this transition between the glass and the brick. So we made some tests of this, could be like that. So that was like, yeah, a hole, like a shade, or a bit of patches of glass, like scattering over it. In the end, yeah, we came into a quite reasonable transition. So kind of a gradient from brick, glass brick, you fade into the real brick. That was approved by the city. Everybody was happy. Then we made some new renderings, and then the whole thing started, because then we had this brick, and we had this fantastic idea, and we wanted to find out how could it work. We first tried other materials, but ultimately, this brick, this was from Venice, was so amazing that everybody fell in love with it, and said, okay, let's do it like this. Let's make the building out of these bricks, even though we didn't really know how to do it. These bricks were made by hand in Venice, and they were very strong and heavy, but it's not easy to glue them together. So that was the difficulty. And we had to prove that the foot was also strong enough. When we went to this factory, it also became clear that they could not only make bricks, they could basically make everything out of glass. So this is, you see the wooden window frame, then in the shape of glass. And when we saw that and we took our client and to see it, and he was like, yeah, okay, this is even better. So he accepted the delay, he accepted the explosion of the building cost. Which of course it was only a facade, so it was relative, it was still a lot of money, but it was not, we're not talking a huge amount of money. But there was a crucial moment when he thought it was not architecture anymore, but it was art. He is an art collector, this is a developer, and for him it was not a big deal to spend a lot of money on a painting, much more than the building cost of our little project. So when we told him that it is actually an art piece, then he was, yeah, but then it's actually really cheap. So that was an interesting revelation moment. And then time didn't matter, and only quality mattered. So as long as it had to be perfect, but that was the only thing that was counting. So we found some super smart girls in Delft that were studying on materials, and they did all kind of research on the strengths of glue and glass. And so this was the how can you stick these glass blocks together? Because the force is okay, but the tension is the problem. It's very, very strong in compression, but two of these blocks, they easily slide. So there's all kind of glues. You use them as well in the dentist situation. You have this ultraviolet light, and then it gets stuck. And you can glue them together, and it proved to be strong enough. There were tests being done, how much force was needed to break it, and it was actually pretty amazing that this, it was not a cheap solution, but it was a super strong solution. So then the next step was how to make all these special bricks that were in the architraves, because the gluing had to be done horizontally. But all these bricks have a little angle, so this was also a complicated thing. And the guys in Delft were really good at it. So let me see. They made a little machine to build the architrave. I love this thing. So it became a gigantic puzzle again. All the bricks were made in Italy, and they were stored in a hole. And then step by step, pieces of the building were glued together, in this case the architraves. And every time the thing was twisting, and then they would glue them again, turn the thing a little bit, glue, turn, glue. And this element was like prefabricated and then brought to the building site. That was one part. They did also the testing of it, of course. They made it a mock-up until it broke. It's in a way the basics of architecture, you could say. It made a hell of a noise when it broke. But it was in the regulations. All this was needed to get the building approval. Otherwise the city would not accept the material. Of course, you could say it got really out of hand, you could say, but on the other hand, everybody was also very excited that this would actually become realized. So there you see the broken beam. All right, here we had our approval drawings. It looked pretty normal from a black and white perspective. Here the rendering, and there's the finished result. And when it was finished, you could see that people started to touch it. They're like, hey, what's this? You know, walking by, like, oh, hey, is it real? And so when you stand there for a while, you see this kind of things. So, within 1 hour, this was still, the building was quite new. It's not like that anymore, but still. So here this a little movie of the construction, because this was such a kind of crazy, it was not a normal building site, because it was almost like a laboratory. The dust had to go out. It was all the bricks had to be glued in a kind of controlled condition. So the last one is this one, and then I end the lecture. So these were the old houses. So the beginning of the construction was quite normal. So there was a steel structure, and then they built the brick part on top. And there was a big hole where the glass facade was going to be. In the meantime, in Italy, all the bricks were made, polished. I don't tell you how expensive one brick is. It's pretty crazy. And these are the supporting walls behind it. So you have the facade, and then there's two fins, more or less, like an old church you would have this, supporting the facade. They were also of glass. So the construction workers, they had to get a special training how to glue the bricks, because you would first put the glue, then the UV light, and then they have a blow dryer to dry it. Everything was hidden behind this sort of dust-free screen, so nobody would actually see something from the outside. For months there was this white box standing in the street, and behind these guys were working. Everything was done, then the building was more or less born and shown to the city. So Chanel was actually not it was not designed for them. They were having a shop further down the street, and they needed a temporary shop here. So they will be 2 years in this building, and then they will move out, and somebody else will move in. All right, thanks a lot. Hope you enjoyed it.
10:36, that's not bad. I think we should go for 11 o'clock. Let's have some questions. Or are you still digesting it? That is a question.
I want to go back to the first part of your lecture where you're talking about the 1 BHK and the 4 BHK. India has a lot of structural inequality. Mm-hmm. So I was curious how you were able to build a building with very different size of houses. And as well, I'd like to know how you, coming from the Netherlands, respond to that structural inequality in your practice of architecture in India.
Yeah, that's of course something that you realize immediately. On the other hand, solving it all is not a kind of issue. But I think what we try to do is to show a way to do it to deal with it in a different way. So by mixing certain housing types instead of separating them, there will be more interaction between different users of these apartments than in a normal way. But of course, these apartments are let's say middle class. They're not the top, but they're sort of they're kind of, I don't know what they cost, but exactly. But it's let's say starting houses for middle class couples. They buy them, but there's also people that buy a super expensive one and they're in the same lift. Let's say. So it is, in a way, a small step, but it's not more than that. Yeah, that's I think what you can do. Yeah.
Other questions? I would like to know where you're living yourself.
Yeah, well,
where's your house?
I am a bit like this house is in the. It's not a DIY house, but it's somehow a townhouse. Yeah, but I used to live in the harbor in Rotterdam, in a kind of woon-werkwoning. It's not officially allowed to live there, but with some tricks, it was okay. But after a while, the city was too attractive, and I came back to the center. Yeah, so it's an old house. Yeah. And I think a lot of architects live in old houses, actually. I don't know why. But at the same time, if the health of the doctor and the architect, the house of the architect, it's not the same as the stuff that you do for others. Yeah.
Jacob, we have a lot of students here. And for about, I think, 15 years ago, Jean-Noël said that the future of architecture not going to be architectural anymore. So you mentioned a little bit about this role, but how do you see this future of architects?
Yeah, that's a big topic, but you can see where architects are working. It's not all people who are at architecture school or will work in architecture offices anymore. And it's a much broader thing. Some people go to the other side, or let's say become developers. Other people go into gaming and the three-dimensional aspects of programming almost. You see that so architecture is a bit, it's quite a broad study, you could say. Other people go into a technological direction. So that's, I think, the. But in general, when I'm teaching in Berlin, but yeah, you see that there's also a lot of people that go in social design, these kind of things, that become kind of collectives, much more than before. Our office is in a way a collective, but you see that this collective element becomes more and more important. Yeah, these are some trends, you could say.
Any more questions there in the back? Can you catch? That would be unwise.
Hello, sir. Sir, I wanted to ask regarding the apartment scheme you have proposed in Pune. So it has a slant edge. Mm-hmm. So that Pune is actually a very heavy rain zoned area. So how have you managed it? construction-wise?
Yeah, there's also kind of a there's no rain pipes on the outside, but they go to the inside. You have, of course, when you have a normal Indian apartment, it has a facade that goes like this, and there's a lot of pipes on the facade.
Yeah.
Pretty. There's air conditioning everywhere, and these kind of things, these units. And so the buildings, they get more or less taken over by all kind of little add-ons. So it might happen that this will be the case in Pune too. But you see what we try to make all the, let's say, all the pipes, their courtyards, I didn't show that. Yeah, they're like 10 by 6, more or less. It's like a huge shaft. And that's why all the pipes are.
Okay.
And then for the balconies on the roof, yeah, they go back to these shafts.
Right.
Yeah, there is, but there will be some water indeed rolling off the roof here and there. But
will
come. But then I think it's. I don't really mind that the building. I think the building can stand these add-ons. I'm not sure. The first people that already moved in, they started already to do stuff on the balcony, and yeah, that's. I think it's quite cool. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah,
what we try to do is to have a little niche for the air conditioner that it's not hanging on the outside, but it's on the small improvement, you could say, but modest. But it's still, yeah, we ask, okay, why don't we do central air conditioning instead of all these little air conditioners? And that was just not an issue. You know, it's not going to happen. Forget about it. We don't trust central machines. It will fail. It will be a mess. And then in the end, people will do it, and it's too expensive. So. It's, yeah, you make a basic building, and then the people will still add these little air conditioning units. So maybe in 20 years this issue is solved, but at the moment central air conditioning is not an issue for residential towers in Pune. Yeah.
Hi. Here.
Oh, hi.
I just have a kind of follow-up question to what you were saying about the role of architects. Here we are coming all together from different countries, and I think architecture has become very globalized, and you are working in projects all over the world. So I just wanted to ask, what do you think are good tools or a good attitude that as an architect you have to take when you're approaching a new context that maybe is foreign to you?
Yeah, that's true, because every time there's a new adventure, every project is a new adventure, and it can be a local adventure, it can be a foreign adventure. So I showed the projects I showed about Holland is that we also take it in a way, yeah, you look like a stranger to your own place as well. So it can help to look at it from, hey, what should I do? What's the best direction to take? And what we try to do in it is that every context has a certain approach, and you say, well, this will never work here, but it could work there. And so you have to choose your battle. It's fine, this is important, and the other thing I let go, or I want to control everything, that's difficult. So you have to say, you have to play that game of letting go of certain things, but trying to hold on other things, and fight for the things that you really think are important, and you say, well, yeah, try to find out what's the best, kind of, what will give the best result.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I would like to ask a very general question. Can you share your experience of your first project as an architect, or how did you deal with it? What was the project about?
As a student or as an architect?
No, as an architect, as a professional.
The first, Anna already explained it a little bit. So we didn't have an office, and there was a kind of a company who was looking for an architect, and they were looking for an architect without experience, so that was quite special. And then because they were, for instance, also working with artists and filmmakers without experience, and for their own new building, they said, why don't we use an architect without experience? So they actually were starting to look for student architects, and then their advising team said, no, maybe that's a bit too much, but you could start maybe look for a young architect. So we were in the selection, and then this was in a way the bit of the action we took to get that project. So, but this was not a typical thing, of course, because normally it's very difficult to get a project because you have to show like three other projects that are similar, and you have whatever. So you have to compete in many levels first. Before you can enter the selection, you have already shown. Yeah, you have to already take a lot of effort, put a lot of time on this. So this is a bit annoying. Of course, you have certain competitions. You have things like Archiprix that helped. Maybe certain cities say, "Hey, we should do something for this for the younger architects." Maybe the ones that did Archiprix or others have a certain a special position. We should give them a chance. So this is a little bit happening in Holland again because people realize the same offices will do the same things. Because even for us, it's very difficult to get a certain commission. Yeah, then we even have to hire or work together with a foreign architect in our own country. We had to do that to participate in a theater competition. And we worked with a Canadian office who built lots of theaters. And we told them, honestly, guys, we only want you because of your experience. But I think, nevertheless, it's nice to work together. And they said, yeah, we are true. We have never worked in Holland, so let's do it. Then we were ranked as first for the competition because we had most points. So this is a bit of a strange, bizarre situation. But that's maybe it will take time to change that. I'm not sure how that works in India. We have maybe more competitions and selections. You have to find a way to say where am I putting my effort in? How to or you have to become your own architect and developer. Some younger offices in the Netherlands there was not enough work. They were looking for sites and buildings and try to organize their own projects. And this is happening in certain places as well, also in Spain. I think there was also pretty hard conditions at the moment, and still there's interesting stuff happening already again. Yeah.
Great, I think give him a final applause. Yeah.